Hello everyone, my name is Gabriel Katamura, and so I'm at the University of Washington, currently studying machine learning. Mainly I sort of tend to work on CDRs, which are call records, but actually this summer I was in Nairobi working for IBM Research with Jay Taneja, who's going to be at UMass Amherst. And we're looking at this new different problem, which is basically a problem of if we have some satellite imagery of roads, we're interested in saying, can we do a prediction of how good the road is? Is the road's quality good? And so, you know, just to motivate this a little bit for you guys, I think in itself it's quite an interesting and useful thing to have, especially in areas where, you know, there's not very much sort of data. So, you know, if you know if a road is good, you can actually sort of say, okay, I know that my transportation for my company can use this route because it can handle big trucks. You know, we can move some merchandise through here. But also, you know, governments know that they need to improve in some areas versus other areas. So, you know, that's definitely good. But, you know, this becomes doubly important when you have some areas such as sub-Saharan Africa where the data is sort of just not as rich. I think in the U.S., you know, the Department of Highways and Transport will do a lot of sort of checks and, you know, actually get real ground data. And sometimes, you know, we just don't have that richness, or we have it much less frequently in some parts of the world. So we think this problem is really quite pertinent. And so what we're doing is we were trying to do basically an initial attempt to sort of say, is this really feasible just from satellite data that we can obtain? And, you know, if it's feasible, what sort of methods will be working well on this? So let me give you just a bit of background first. Is like, you know, I've talked about road quality. Okay, well, I need to define road quality. And so what we have is this nice sort of thing, which is actually being used by the World Bank, which is called the International Roughness Index. And what this does is it's basically taking some information from a car that's driving over a road and sort of saying, you know, how the car is moving from side to side, up and down, and, you know, running this through an algorithm and giving you just one number for sort of stretch of road. And, you know, that number, if it's lower, sort of telling you that's a better stretch of road than another one, which is higher. You know, it's not technically meant to sort of be absolutely ride quality or vibration level or any of this stuff, but it correlates very strongly with, you know, the sort of perceived quality of a road and stuff like that. So, you know, this is a nice thing. It gives us a sort of baseline, though, what are we going to try and predict? And the nice thing is that in Kenya we have quite a nice data set for this. We have 54 roads, and in total, you know, if you look even at just the 2011 data we have for this IRI, it adds up to like, you know, I think 10,000 kilometers, so it's like a great amount of roads. And the other thing which is very nice for this sort of prediction problem is the IRI measurements are given in terms of latitudes and longitudes, and they're actually very close by. They give you sort of 10-meter stretches of road each time. So, you know, that's good. We can do some very fine-grained prediction, essentially. So, okay, so, you know, we know roughly what we're trying to predict, so let's talk about what is it going to do specifically. Well, you know, I think the ideal case is we want to prove that we can do the most sort of, the most granular, the most sort of informative thing, which is for each little 10-meter stretch of road here, which you can see in this sort of like green rectangles, we just want to grab the stuff from the satellite data, we want to do some sort of machine learning magic on it, and we want to return a prediction for the quality of the road that hopefully is pretty good. And so, you know, this is an interesting machine learning problem in itself, but of course, you want to have some sort of like reason to do this other than to just get grant money or whatever. So, what are sort of applications here? Well, for me, I'm sort of looking to sort of provide just a sort of building block on which you can do downstream analysis. So, you know, the simplest sort of thing to say is, okay, so I've built this model that seems to be pretty good at, you know, handling these road IRIs. Now, there might be a road that we just haven't had the chance to drive some sort of measurement vehicle over. Maybe it's too remote, maybe the area was recently dangerous. And now we can just quickly say, okay, we're going to go over there and we're going to just make a guess of how good it is for some sort of application. And, you know, but even like within a country that, for example, in Kenya, where we have gone over the roads in 2015, it might be nice to be able to update, you know, maybe it's been a year since we've gone over the road. Has there been a lot of adverse weather? Has there been a lack of maintenance? Conversely, has there been some construction projects? And, you know, it would be good to at least get an estimate to see if that's changing, because that might, you know, sort of change how businesses want to do their sort of logistics or what governments might want to do. Another interesting one, which I'll talk a little bit more after I talk about the implementation, is to actually say, you know, can we go back in time and say, we have great satellite images maybe for a bunch of stuff, but maybe pre-2011 we don't have many IRI measurements. If we have a good enough model, would it be possible to actually go back and sort of predict, oh, in 2008 this road was this good or it was this bad? So, you know, maybe we talk about that a little bit later. So, you know, this work, I think we've sort of discussed why it's important. I also want to say it's sort of motivated by the fact that there's some great stuff has been done on satellite imagery. I think there's some really great work from Stanford where they're actually able to predict sort of the poverty of a region from satellite images. I think that some of the authors are in the audience today. And this is really great. So, you know, it sort of gives us the idea that this might be possible, but this is also quite like a focus thing. It's looking just at a road and something very specific about a road. So when I was looking at the implementation, I was just trying to say, is this going to be even possible? So let's find some sort of implementation that's not too sort of laborious to do, but hopefully will give us good enough results to sort of decide if we want to pursue this further. So first question is, well, where do you get your satellite images? So just in terms of convenience, we ended up going with Google Maps just because we needed something where we can grab as much as we can. And they do a lot of nice stuff to filter out like different light levels, different, you know, cloud cover, all this stuff, which is not something I want to spend 2 months on, you know, just to figure out it doesn't work. So that is great. It also does have a problem, though, that we don't know much about the date at which something is. And, you know, some parts of Google Maps are sort of images from earlier or later. So that's a small problem that we'll come back to. Once we have this sort of source of data, what we want to do is we want to say, okay, so what am I going to, I need to sort of standardize the size of my patch. So we went with 10 meters, because that's the sort of length we have in IRI, the most granular one, and 20 meters to capture, you know, multi-lane roads as well as smaller roads. You know, you need to be a little bit careful here. The data is not always perfect. I've shown an illustration where if you were just going by the raw IRI values, you'd end up, you know, saying that this grassland is a great piece of road. In reality, you know, you need to be careful. I used OpenStreetMaps in this case to correct and just throw away data where there's too much disagreement. But there's been some great work on just road detection via satellite images that in the ideal case, that's what you would want to do. So I'll talk just a little bit about the sort of featurization we do here. So, you know, you can take a patch and you can try feeding that to a machine learning algorithm, but it really doesn't like just a bunch of, like, you know, pixel color values. It doesn't tend to do well. So I picked this quite interesting paper by Adam Coates from Stanford, where he's actually able to do some pretty good prediction on difficult image tasks by just taking some small sub-patches from that, by which I mean if you see this main patch of road over there, you can take smaller subsections of it, and you basically want to take a look at those. So for example, you can take all the 16 by 16 sub-patches and all the 8 by 8 sub-patches. And what we're going to do is we're going to try and find these, we're going to try and look at all these patches, and we're going to try and find some representative ones out of there. You know, for example, we might say that, oh, there's a 16 by 16 sub-patch that tends to show up as the edge of a road or a bump in the road or something like that. And then if we can detect that many times in a tile, that's a good start. That's something which we can do training on. So, yeah, as I said, what you do is you get all of these sub-patches. You do some operations we call normalization and whitening, which helps you deal with a lot of the variance in the data that might otherwise mess up a k-means algorithm. And once you have that, you try and get these, like I said, these representative sub-patches. And so I've given you some examples over here where you sort of like, again, they're very small, so they're a bit hard to interpret, but you see things that look like the edges of paved roads or some concrete versus some, you know, indistinct edges of dirt roads, etc. And then, as I said, for each sort of patch we get, each full 10-meter stretch of road, we're going to try and see, can I see a lot of this boundary of this paved road, you know, this sort of sub-patch, does it appear anywhere? And if so, you'd hope that a training algorithm would be able to sort of figure that out and, you know, assign some good score to it. I don't talk much about training algorithm because it's actually very simple. It's just regularized regression, ridge regression. So the actual strength is in the featurization itself. So, yeah, as I said, here the question we want to ask is basically, so can we even do this in the first place? And, you know, if so, what can we learn from this sort of like, are some roads better, are some methods better, et cetera? So I'll start with the sort of very simplest thing we can do, which is just the traditional machine learning method here. So what we do here is we grab each stretch of road as a different data set, and then we take this data set, we randomly put some in the training bucket, some in the test bucket, and, you know, building a model on one, we try and predict on the other. And so, you know, this is quite interesting because you have a big variation here. You have some roads which are only some 20 or so kilometers. In fact, if you look at this graph, the ones on the left tend to be shorter while the ones on the right are very long. They're sort of around 400 kilometers in length. And what we're doing now is we're seeing what is the test score when we use this prediction methodology. What is the test score basically on this held out set? And we do it for some different sort of amounts of clusters. Here again, we're actually doing something even simpler than a subpatch method, just to see if like, we can do something with the data. And the results, you know, if I were to bring out sort of one sort of two takeaways. First one is like, it's not bad actually. You know, we're getting some 0.3 R squared, which is not bad for some of them. And the other thing to point out is that sort of the score does increase as you add more. So in fact here it's not like we sort of reached the limit on even a very simple featurization. It's just something that I stopped in terms of like, you know, time and computational resources. But you know, it's good to see that even sort of basic methods can do something here. Now, you know, I talked about this sort of sub-patching method. And so what we do here is I'm going to show you the difference between if you're using just a very sort of simple, just pixel-based sort of almost color histogram versus this sub-patch method. And sort of the blue ones are the sort of simple method, and the red ones are the sub-patch-based method that Coates describes. And first thing to note is the scale is different. Like some of these are sort of 150% of the sort of original test score. So that's good. It's good, encouraging to see that seems like an appropriate choice. And the other thing is that like this is something which is impacted by the size of the road. If you have rather a small road, it's actually hard to get good representative clusters. The k-means just doesn't have much data to work with. But as you go into, you know, hundreds of kilometers, then you actually find some very good cluster means. Another thing which I like to do, I mean, we always talk about aggregate stats and machine learning. A lot of people don't actually try and look into sort of inspecting specific cases. But this is actually quite a visual problem. So what you can do is you can sort of overlay the actual road with visual representations of how well you're predicting. So the green squares are things that are being predicted better, and then orange or even red squares are things that are being predicted poorly. And you know, just sort of small analysis is we were worried about sort of the curvature of roads, but it seems this subpatch method was quite resilient to like handling those, so that's good. But we do have some issues with like debris and stuff like that, sort of just sort of things that might be very temporal, just like there in one image but gone the next. And I'll talk a little bit later about how to possibly handle that. Now the other problem we have is like, okay, I've talked to you about this sort of very nice train test thing where I take one test set, but in reality what you're going to have is you're going to have a bunch of roads in your training set, and then you're going to have a completely new road which you want to test on. And this is kind of a pain because it actually breaks a lot of rules of ML where you like to say the train and the test are drawn from the same distribution. Here you cannot make this assumption. So instead here we have a result where basically we take all the other roads and then we try and do a prediction on this road C30. And so the red line represents, you know, what you would get if you just used the held out roads sort of IRI by itself. And you know, this sort of means that roughly half the time you're just giving a completely wrong prediction. And the yellow one represents the sort of model you get when you do the real sort of train test thing. And that's saying that basically all but 6% of the time you're getting the right value. And it's nice to see that as we train on more of the held out data set, this is the blue line, we actually can do an okay job. I think there's still a lot of room to improve here. But you know, it's better than just like doing sort of a dumb thing and not being able to get any results at all. So you know, this isn't as strong as the traditional train test thing, something to work on, especially because we have this issue with different distributions of IRIs. But it's sort of an encouraging start. If I were to say the main takeaways from my side is I wanted to sort of ask, is this sort of like possible? Is it a good thing to spend some more time on? And I think it seems the answer is yes, so that's good. Even with train data, which, as I said, has this big problem that essentially we don't really know if it's exactly at the same time as the IRI measurements were taken. The second thing is like more data and more computing power is going to improve these results. It's sort of just a lower threshold, so that's good. And then, you know, the thing which we want to focus on is how to handle these held out roads that might have very different distributions from the entire train set. That's sort of an interesting problem from an ML perspective and will be very important for applications. So, you know, I think we've done this initial thing, but I think the next steps will need to sort of be grounded in what is sort of what is important to folks. What sort of applications are they going to be envisioning? So I talked very briefly about this one, about this economic study idea. And the idea here is that like, okay, so if we can, you know, if we can take a bunch of data from 2015 and we can make a model and it looks good, and now we have some data from 2011, if we can get satellite images from 2011 and go back and try applying our model and it's good, that's quite interesting because it means that like from some data taken in, you know, the future, we can make some predictions about the past, which would be really cool because then you can go back maybe to 2008 and make some predictions about how good the roads were in 2008 and 2004, you know, modular satellite images being of high enough quality. And this might be very useful for some economic studies. You can, you know, say, okay, say I want to analyze how the road quality is impacting economic results, and I have results for 10 years or something. This might fill in some data that you are missing on the road quality side. You know, I'm not sort of an economist by any means, so obviously there's a lot of stuff to account for, be careful with, but certainly something to look at. The other stuff I would like to investigate more is methodological questions. You know, the main reason I didn't use DNNs is just because they're sort of hard, and I didn't want to spend, you know, 3 months working on them and then being like, oh, didn't work. But now that it seems like this is, you know, a good thing to try, I'm very interested in this. This was very applicable in the Stanford paper. And the second one, which is sort of different from that, is we have this very sequential nature of prediction. You know, make a prediction on a road segment, then the next road segment is, you know, physically sequential to it. So a very interesting idea here, which is sort of different from stuff that's been done, is some sort of hidden Markov model style, which is able to sort of try and infer some latent variables like IRI based on these visual elements and then, you know, connect them sequentially. So that might be very interesting, but, you know, something to sort of look at in the future. Well, great. Thank you very much for listening. This is my contact info if you want to email me any questions, or feel free to chat to me afterwards.